I believe I've had the privilege of meeting many of you, but for those who don't know me, my name is Jeremy Paul, and I have the extraordinary pleasure of serving as Dean here at Northeastern University School of Law, and I have the privilege also of serving as Master of Ceremonies at this wonderful tribute for our beloved Steve Subrin. I'm grateful to each and every one of you for being here. My family will tell you that there's nothing I like more than throwing a party. And it's a fitting tribute to Steve, that so many have gathered in such a beautiful setting, and that we have such a distinguished lineup of speakers. But before we get to the distinguished group, Steve, let me be the first to congratulate you and thank you for all you've done for so many people for so many years at Northeastern. And Joni, let me thank you too for sharing him with us for all these years. It's hard for many of us to wrap our minds around what 46 years of teaching represents, but we see it personified in the many graduates who have learned so much from Steve. If you want a timeline, consider that the day Steve first walked through Northeastern's doors was closer chronologically to the start of the Great Depression than it is today. It's hard even to imagine the many changes that Steve has witnessed over the years, but it's safe to say that he has always been someone to adapt to changing times, even if he hasn't always liked all the changes, such as the Supreme Court's recent civil procedure decisions. But as Northeastern now heads into years without Steve in his formal teaching role, we all continue to face dramatic change in our profession. One of my colleagues recently mentioned to me that she had gone to our library and was unable to even find U.S. reports on the shelves because everything is electronic and online. And what I always say to people in thinking about how to cope with all these changes, the challenge for the generation of leaders is we can't possibly transmit our practices because those are obsolete, but our goal is to transmit our values. And Steve, you've been a pillar doing that for so many years, and I'm just going to mention three lessons that I've learned from you, and you can tell me at the end if I've got them right. The first is that Northeastern should be a school in which collaboration among the students and the faculty is more important than competition. Sometimes people say to me, how can it be that you want to send students out into the world who are not competitive? And my response to that is, on a basketball team, you want people to compete against the other team, but on your own team, you want them to pass you the ball if you're open, as opposed to hogging the ball for their stats. And that's the kind of teamwork that I think Steve has stressed for so many years. The second is, people learn how to be lawyers by doing, as well as by sitting in classrooms. And the beauty of the co-op program is that people are out experiencing life and what it means to be a professional, not just learning from books. And the final one, and this is what I hear Steve talk about all the time, is we expect each and every one of our graduates to strive to leave the world a better place than it was when they found it, when they first got here. And Steve, we're so grateful to you for all of that. So now let me say a little bit about the proceedings. I'm not going to come back up here between each and every speaker, so each speaker will have to introduce himself or herself. You'll hear from many people. Guest speakers include faculty, former dean, former students and friends, and they'll share memories. As Dan said, most of them will be positive. I do have the privilege of introducing our first speaker, who is the Attorney General of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Maura Healy. Attorney General Healy was sworn in this past January of 2015, pledging to lead the people's law firm, and she has certainly hit the ground running. She has tackled issues touching the lives of residents across Massachusetts, including the heroin and prescription drug abuse epidemic, escalating healthcare costs, workers' rights, and student loan costs. She's focused on strengthening consumer protections and on improving our criminal justice system. She launched the Community Engagement Division, the first of its kind, bringing the Attorney General's office and its work into neighborhoods and communities across the state. Attorney General Healy has been an advocate for a more equal and inclusive workplace, and in May 2015, she announced that her office would provide 6 weeks of paid family leave for all employees. As the former head of the Office of Civil Rights Division, Attorney General Healy was the architect of the state's successful challenge to the Federal Defense of Marriage Act and argued the case in federal court. Prior to her election as Attorney General, Maura Healy helped lead the Attorney General's office as head of the Civil Rights Division and as chief of the Public Protection and Business and Labor Bureaus. Attorney General Healy grew up the oldest of five brothers and sisters in Hampton Falls, New Hampshire, and graduated from Harvard College in 1992 and was captain of the women's basketball team. As we all know, she's a proud graduate of Northeastern, class of 1998, and it's my pleasure to introduce her to you. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much, Dean Paul. It is great to see you. Thank you so much for all that you do for the law school. It was a pleasure last May to be with you and last year's graduates at the commencement ceremony. And I thank you. I just want to tell you folks, I am so happy to be here tonight. It's true, in my new gig, I get invited to a lot of events, but I can't tell you how much this makes me so happy to be here. Not only is it an incredible honor to try to speak on behalf of so many of my friends I look at my classmates, some of you, and so many of you who I have come to know through the wonderful Northeastern community. It is an honor, but I have to tell you, it makes me so happy because I absolutely adore Steve Subrin. And before I say something about Steve, I also see so many wonderful and amazing professors, faculty members, present and former, in the room tonight, in addition to alumni. And I know I speak on behalf of all Northeastern graduates in congratulating you on birthing all of us and playing such a critical role in our professional development and, I think for many of us, personal growth and development. So great to see all of you, and thank you for all that you do. So it's not often that you are given an opportunity to really say thank you to someone who has made such a profound impact on one's life, at least while they're alive. But this is nice this evening to be able to do that because Steve Subrin has had such a tremendous impact on my life. I think back to 1994, and I was with my mother. This was pre-Marino Center, so we were parked in some spot where the Marino Center currently is. And we were walking across Huntington Ave and the tracks there, and we were looking for the law school because I had applied to and had been accepted at Northeastern. And as we walked down Huntington, we saw coming into view a person who maybe looked like a law professor. Now, I gotta tell you, and trust me, I'm all Northeastern values. We did unconscious bias training at the Attorney General's office out of the gate. So I don't mean to stereotype here, but does anyone look like more than a law professor than Steve Subrin? Special protected class. Thinking he might work at the law school, if not teach at the law school, we approached him and asked him where the law school was. And that led to a terrific conversation, and he ended up taking us not only to the law school, but actually back to his office. And we know how special Steve's office is, with all sorts of interesting law review articles and books and pictures of his family and the like. And we must have sat for a good 45 minutes. And I have to tell you, that was a conversation that started on the train tracks, essentially, but one that has continued for really the last 25 years. And 23 years, we're working on 25. Steve Subrin is why I went to Northeastern. We hit it off immediately. There was some commonality. We had both gone to Harvard College. We shared that bond. We had a shared love of basketball, which was a real soft spot for me, as you know. And in the years that have come to pass, we have had, I can't tell you how many boring conversations, or at least boring to many, but not to us, about the NCAA tournament, about the demise of fundamentals in the game, about the fact that it's become way too much of a big person's game. We're both vertically challenged, as you can see, and so it's really troubling because it's all become a game that's played above the rim. And you know, this is like what we talk about, in addition to beginning each year with an assessment of the Celtics roster and their chances. So that, look, I went to Northeastern, I will tell you publicly, or tell those publicly, it was for the values and the public interest, the co-op experience, and all of that good stuff. But probably fundamentally, it was because of this guy and the fact that I met somebody who equaled my love of basketball in that office that afternoon. But in all seriousness, what struck me as we talked, and as we've talked since, is his ability to convey, without even trying, what Northeastern was all about, the value of training new lawyers, what it meant to be a lawyer, what it meant to seek justice and be an advocate, what it meant to think like a lawyer and to use the law and the rule of law to make justice and equality and opportunity real for people. He talked to me that day, as you've heard him talk, about students, and you can just feel it so palpable, Steve's love of his students. So I was immediately hooked. A week later, I sent my deposit right in, and months later, I showed up on campus, where I was initially thrilled to find myself in Professor Subrin's civil procedure class. I say initially because the first week, it was tough. It was really tough for those of us, I don't know, Professor Wu, others, this was a really tough course that we were subjected to, I use that word intentionally. It was tough. A total foreign language, and he was all about, you know, 12b-6 and international shoe and summary judgment, and how often I see Jeff here, mediation and what has happened to the jury trial. He's been looking for the jury trial for the last 25 years anyways. Thank God Larry Citrullo's here, who actually, Larry does try cases. That actually is still happening. But every year in Doxer, this is old Doxer, not the new fancy place many of you get to go now, but the old school Doxer down in the basement, this was a place we had to be on our toes every afternoon. And through it all, the discussion of the rules, exciting and mundane, I think what we learned along the way, or at least what I learned, was why those rules actually mattered. I didn't appreciate it at the time, but once I got into what became the ongoing practice of law, and trust me, I'm still practicing. The other day I got to carry an actual red weld. I was so excited for a moment because I don't get to do that much anymore. But when I did start to get out and practice, it really all then made sense, and it started to sink in all that Steve had taught to me and so many about what it meant to be a civil litigator. Flash forward a few years, many years, I made a decision to leave a job that I love and run to be Attorney General. And I have to tell you that one of the first calls I made was to Steve to ask him whether he thought it was a good idea. He thought it was great. But I know he would have said that anyways because he's a super supportive friend and mentor. But he became really engaged in what I was trying to do in my run and was with me every step of the way. And I am grateful to him. I'm grateful for the Northeastern community. Not only did it, I'll just say this, I would not be Attorney General today were it not for Northeastern. And I don't just mean that in the sense that it was a school where I matriculated from, which is a requirement if you want to be AG, which is actually good. But it's because it's the place that instilled in me the values of public service and public interest and social justice and the rule of law and how that can have a profound impact day out, day in and day out in courts and situations around our state, around our country. And that is something that I learned, so many of us learned from Steve. In closing, I just want to say that behind every great man is at least one great woman, and Steve is lucky to have no less than four and extended family and grandchildren here. To Joni and your wonderful daughters, thank you. I want to say thank you for letting us all be a part of your family all of these years. And Steve, nobody deserves a happier, healthier, more fulfilling retirement than you. So congratulations, thanks for everything.
My name is Larry Citrullo, and although I am honored to have been asked to speak tonight, I have no idea why I was asked to speak. I hardly know the man, but General Healy just said all the important things, and I'm grateful for that, but she took most of my remarks. So I think what I will do is dispense with that and discuss two aspects of Steve's multi-talented career that, but for my testimony, I don't know that would be mentioned. The first is that before there was Northeastern University School of Law, there was Burns and Levinson in Professor Subrin's life. And for those of you who are not familiar with Burns and Levinson circa 1960 to 1975 or so, the stress was unbelievable of a law firm trying cases every single day. Imagine a crucible of learning in the most stressful environment conceivable, trying cases, and then imagine doing it with a titan of the trial bar named Tom Burns. And when I arrived at Burns and Levinson in 1976, Steve Subrin was already legendary at Burns and Levinson for two particular reasons. One is he was a notable trial lawyer in a firm full of great trial lawyers. And the second, and probably more notable and more important, was that one day, Steve woke up and said, I don't need this anymore, and I don't like it very much anymore. And he went into the office of the scariest person that I've ever met, and believe me, I grew up being intimidated by professional intimidators. And he walked into the office of Tom Burns, and he told Tom what he thought of the daily trial of cases and what his plans were for Northeastern University School of Law and the rest of his life, and the rest of his life with his family and Joni and the girls. And the rumor, the legend was at Burns and Levinson that as Tom began his harangue, Steve put up his hand, Tom slunk back and agreed with Steve. And the legend was formed that this was the only time that in anybody's memory that Tom Burns had ever acquiesced an idea that he thought was not well taken, and Steve was the man to make him do it. And believe me, he was legendary when I arrived at Burns and Levinson, and if you ask people at Burns and Levinson today, they'll still recount the tale of Steve's glorious exit from the firm. Now the second the second notable aspect of Steve's repertoire of talents has to do with the game of ping pong. Now, I learned how to play ping pong in Newark, New Jersey, at some of the toughest boys clubs east of the Mississippi, and I thought I was pretty good. And about 2 weeks into my career at Northeastern University School of Law in September 1972, the challenge was made, the gauntlet was thrown down, and I was summoned to the ping pong table to do battle with Steve Subrin and his second, Dan Gavelber. And so the game began in furious pace back and forth to 21, winner of the point retains the serve, got to win by two, back and forth. And at one point, I had the serve, and I announced the score as I was about to serve, and I said, it's 17-15, and as I was about to serve the ball, Steve put up his hand, and as he did with Tom Burns so many years before, very firmly but calmly, he said, no, the score is 17-16. And so I, not yet hysterical, I became hysterical shortly afterwards, but not yet being hysterical, I said, no, the score is 17-15. Steve said, no, it's 17-16. I said, Steve, I'm ahead 17-15. Well, this went back and forth for, oh, about 12 minutes. And finally, Dan Gavelber said to Steve, what's with this guy? And Steve, without missing a beat, replied, I don't know him very well, but it seems like he's chosen the right profession. So I feel like I was launched in my career with the good housekeeping seal of Subrin approval, having determined that, yes, this profession was for me. Well, Steve was instrumental in my finding my way to a clerkship in the U.S. District Court for a really unpleasant fellow named Drew Caffrey, but it was a great experience for me, and Steve was instrumental in getting me there. And then when I thought for sure I was unemployable, Steve introduced me to Tom Burns, and presto changeo, I was a trial lawyer at Burns and Levinson in 1976. And for that and so much more, I give my thanks to Steve and to Joni, who has been his stalwart companion and support throughout. And I'm very grateful, as is Lynn, for our friendship with Steve and Joni, and grateful for all that Steve has done for us, the class of 1975, that's very well represented here tonight, Steve, by the way. And grateful for all that you've done and all that you've meant to us and to so many of us for all these years. And I do want to end on this note. In all seriousness, the score was 17-15. And you're leaving the table in a huff made you default the game, and that's all I have to say about that.
Whose water is this?
It's mine now. Good evening. My name is Jeff Feldman. As the Attorney General referenced, and as many of us know, Steve has long been troubled by what the courts have done in the area of civil procedure. In law review articles and in his own textbook, Steve has lamented and criticized court rulings that limit access to justice and erode what he feels to be the core philosophy of the federal rules. It's been, I know, Steve, a long and lonely battle. So as you make your way into retirement, I thought you could use a fashion accessory suitable for the times in which we are definitely now living to help you quietly continue your crusade for a better system of civil justice. So why don't you open that, and then I'll continue. Put it up on the screen. So I contacted some of my former classmates, soliciting stories about Steve that I could share tonight. Unfortunately, my efforts were spectacularly unsuccessful. For example, my good friend Mark Irvings emailed me the following, true story. He wrote me, I'm sorry, I cannot help you out. The only class I had with him was civil procedure. While you were enthralled, I was napping. which is why you went into trial practice and I gravitated to arbitration, where I get to make up all the rules. So, abandoned by my friends, I had to draw on my own memories. But as I thought about it, Mark was right. I was enthralled with civil procedure. Steve was one of those teachers who had a lasting impact on his students, and I was one of them, the fortunate beneficiary of his remarkable dedication, intelligence, and skill. Now, for the first 37 years of life after law school as a practicing trial lawyer, I regularly felt Steve's imprint. It sharply affected how I looked at legal issues and how I developed litigation strategy. Years rolled by, and then decades, and I always heard Steve's voice in my head, and I always felt his guiding touch. Then at the 38-year mark, life took a turn, and I unexpectedly found myself teaching law at the University of Washington. And it was here that I came to appreciate really what the true impact has been of Steve's career. So let me explain to you. As the newest, if not the youngest member of the faculty, I had no control over my course selection. And as luck would have it, I was asked to teach the advanced course, you guessed it, in civil procedure. I'll say parenthetically that when I reported this to Steve, I had a strong sense that he now felt that his life's work was complete. And that one of his own was about to go out and teach young minds about the elegant mysteries and the soaring thrills of the federal rules of civil procedure. So since this was my first time out of the gate as a teacher, I thought it would be a good idea if I touched base with the professor who previously had taught the course. Now this was a woman with truly stunning academic credentials, including having clerked for Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, so you'll understand that I approached my meeting with her with some trepidation. Things were going pretty well until she asked me, have you ever taught civil procedure before? And of course I answered, no, I haven't. And then she asked, well, have you ever taught any law school course? And now feeling a little defensive, I said, no, but I've always had an affection for civil procedure. I had a good professor in law school. Well, her brow furrowed deeply. She was not impressed. Really, she said, who is your professor? And I said, a fellow named Steve Subrin. Well, she got very quiet. In fact, she froze, and her eyes widened to the size of saucers. And she asked me with skepticism, you studied under Steve Subrin? I did, I said. I wasn't sure why she was so skeptical, so I quickly added, I'm a lot younger than I look. I'm impressed, she said. Subrin is a god. Now, her response was quite unexpected, and for some reason, the only thing I could think of to say by way of reply was, he wasn't a god when I knew him. True story. No matter, she was so dazzled, it was as if I was auditioning for the house band at Applebee's and had just told her I'd studied guitar under Eric Clapton. Fortunately for me, my connection to Steve equipped me with just enough credibility that I wasn't promptly run off by the law school. I'm still teaching civil procedure, and my students still hear me regularly channel Steve's voice. So my debt to him, and now my students' debt to him, continues on. So putting the jokes aside for a second, the best and most accurate comment about Steve actually did come from one of my classmates, Kathy Morris. And Kathy wrote me and said, my memories of Steve are in the form of feelings, feelings of being cared about as a student, as a graduate, and as a person. Feelings of being sure that the future mattered in his eyes and that we could and would have roles to play in it. Feelings that where he stood, to this day where he stands, is good and right and true. And though I cannot be there to honor him because of a work commitment, I feel he would understand, because commitment is at the core of what he taught us. Kathy got this completely right. For me and for so many others, Steve, you were and you remain, quite literally, a beloved teacher. And as we celebrate your extraordinary career tonight, on behalf of all of your former students, thank you so much for all that you gave us, and in my case, for all that you're still giving me, and for your enduring contribution to the profession into our law school. Congratulations, Steve. I love you, Professor Subrin.
Steve wanted to know whether I would tell you the truth, and I said, no chance. So what follows is fantasy. We grew up 40 miles from one another. I grew up in Cleveland. Steve grew up in Akron. I joined the faculty a year before Steve, and so I had the privilege of interviewing him when he was a candidate. And we got into a discussion about Northeastern's location and whether or not there was a good place to eat nearby. I advocated the Puritan, which was a hamburger shop across the street. Steve mentioned Joseph's, which at that point was the fanciest restaurant in Boston, but you could walk from Northeastern to Joseph's. Well, once he got to Northeastern, he gave up his Joseph's fantasies and became a big devotee of the Puritan. I want to tell you about Steve, the person, the mensch, not the scholar, although I'm glad to talk about him as a scholar, but this is better. 30 years ago, some of you may know, my son had a terrible accident, our son, Franz, here too, in Maine. He fell off a rope swing onto rocks in a river. He was transported first to a local hospital, then to Maine Medical Center, and for a couple of weeks he was in a coma, for weeks it was touch and go. He's fine now. He's would be here tonight if he didn't live in Washington State. When this happened, I was the dean, so I called Steve to tell him that obviously I was not going to be available for a while. Would he please spread the word? He did. He spread the word. Then he got in his car and he drove from Boston to Portland, Maine, to come and be at Fran and my side and Jesse's while we were dealing with Jonah, who was then in the hospital. This would be an extraordinary act by anybody, but if you know Steve, and you know his relationship to cars, and you know his relationship to cars, to roads on which cars can go quickly, this was an extraordinary act. It's hard to think of anything that anyone has ever done in my life that meant more to me, meant more to Fran, than Steve showing up. He immediately befriended all the nurses. We, as I remember it, started to have endless food that Steve would go out and get. You know, what you need at times like that is some form of distraction, and believe me, Steve was the best distraction imaginable. So whatever you think of him as a teacher, whatever you think of him as a scholar, there's a Yiddish word, mensch, human being. That's where Steve excels. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Tom Main. I'm from the distinguished class of 1994, summer in the house. I'm presently part of the special protected class of civil procedure professors. I teach at UNLV, and I teach civil procedure with delight. It's a pleasure to be here tonight to celebrate somebody who literally is my hero. From the first weeks of law school, I said, that's the job I want. That's the person I want to be. It's the kind of man I want to be. That's the job I want to have. And I've spent my life trying to become my own version of Steve Subrin. There are many memories that I could share, and I've been recollecting so many of them in anticipation of this, but I decided to focus on my first specific memory. So Steve teaches us storytelling, and so I thought I should start at the beginning, and I can only share one. But the specific memory, my very first specific memory, is the first weeks of law school when a student said some comment that as a professor I'm now all too familiar with, said something kind of obtuse and odd, and Steve said, well, first he had the big dramatic Steve pause that we all know well, which today usually means he's about to change the subject to something that we were talking about two subjects ago. But at the time, he just big pause, and then he said, I don't know if that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard or the most profound thing I've ever heard. And I was in love. You know, I think then and many times thereafter, I learned something from, I mean, the exchange was, of course, he interrogates the student, and tragically, the student was hopelessly confused. What they said was unsupported by the law, unsupported by the facts, unsupported even by basic logic. But what I learned from the exchange was that Steve was not going to allow class to run into sort of a crude relativism where bad arguments are going to receive attention. He's not going to allow people to mix facts with opinions. This is something that I think about and is embedded in my syllabus and has been for 15 years. I see it corrupting political conversation today where people believe they can have their own version of the facts and seldom engage in dialogue. Some arguments are better than other arguments. And Steve taught us that in class by forcing us to confront sometimes the weakness of those arguments. He taught us that we're in the business of persuasion. That's the family business. It's the business of lawyers. It might be the business even of citizens to be engaged in the dialogue of persuasion. And Steve recognized that saying something that's an opinion limits dialogue. It reduces the possibility for persuasion. And so his attempt to get even first year students to appreciate that not all arguments are created equal. There might be many right arguments, but that doesn't, I'm sorry, many right answers, but that doesn't mean that there aren't also wrong answers. And for his ability to integrate a warm embrace of different perspectives, a warm embrace of different viewpoints, while also teaching us that there are really bad and silly arguments and that we need to find better arguments when the only arguments we have are silly ones. That's the clarity of vision that that first encounter has lingered with me, that idea that, no, that's a pretty bad answer, and as horrifying as it was in that exchange. And I wasn't that person, I think, unless I've repressed it, which is entirely possible. But I remember learning so much from that, and that similar lesson repeated thereafter. But perhaps what's even more significant is the other half of what he said. Because remember what he said was, that might be the dumbest thing I've ever heard, or it might be the most profound. And that's an exceptional character, because what you have in that comment is somebody at the time who had two Harvard degrees, years of experience in a law firm, years of experience teaching, but was genuinely ready to hear something profound from some person who'd been in law school for 2 or 3 weeks. That is a unique person. He is ready to hear the most profound insight from anyone, including that first-year law student. Indeed, including a sales clerk, a random person walking through the hotel lobby, anybody that he encounters, a four-year-old grandchild, anyone, he is ready to listen and to learn something from that. He's ready to hear the most profound thing that he's heard in a long time from the most unlikely of sources, even from me. And that's been my pleasure to have the opportunity over decades now to try to give him insights, to try to give him something that he can use, something that is moving a conversation in a direction that advances all the values that Northeastern teaches and that so many of us care about. So all of us who graduated from Subrin University have so much to thank Steve for. I try to be a better rhetorician, and I try to be the kind of learner who's ready to learn something from the least likely of sources. And so thank you, Steve. I absolutely love you. Thanks for being my hero.
That was lovely.
So I'm Margaret Wu, and I'm on the faculty. I was lucky because I joined the NUSL faculty at a time when the law school was filled with superstars, people who care about teaching, mentoring, and using law for the public good. And these folks include people who are here today, like Dan Gavelber, Mike Melsner, I think he's in the audience, Judy Brown, Dick Daner, Kyle Clare. But let me just share that Steve Subrin is a superstar, not only at NUSL, but also in China. So what started my long friendship with Steve is our project that was funded by the Ford Foundation, under which we traveled to China no less than 3 times to deliver a series of civil procedure lectures to young and promising civil procedure teachers in China. And so from that trip came our book, Litigating in America, which has been translated and became, I kid you not, a bestseller in China. Who knew? When Steve and I traveled back to China after the book was published, and again, I kid you not, students surrounded him to ask for his autograph. Steve Subrin, the superstar. Okay. But the Steve Subrin I know is not only the one who's a brilliant scholar in civil procedure, but also the one who taught me that we need not be driven by work so much that we forget to have fun, or more importantly, to be human. So I always like to share the story that before Steve Subrin, I call it BSS, not BS, BSS, I would run myself ragged, right? 99, those of you who know me, staying at one-star hotels with cracks in the wall, doing what I call my so-called, you know, field work in China. So then I went and I traveled to China with Steve. By contrast, I stayed at the 5-star Intercontinental. Ford Foundation insisted, because of Steve Subrin, so BSS, again. And every evening, though, on that trip, Steve would pull me aside after I've been running around all day and sit me down for an Irish coffee to hear about my day. And I became more productive because of Steve Subrin, BSS, slow me down to be human. Now, this humanity also showed through at the law school. His one true love other than his family, I think. Or maybe, I don't know, your synagogue, I guess. That's also I know high up there. But having my office right next to Steve, I'm always cognizant of the number of students in and out of his office. And Steve truly cares about his student. He is both their friend, their mentor, keeping track of their progress long after their graduation. He co-authors with them, like Tom Main here, and is a staunch advocate for them, right? And because of Steve Subrin, BSS, I'm gonna kind of ingrain this in all of us, many of them are now leading lawyers, judges, and law faculty members around the country, and as well as here at NUSL. So finally, I should share Steve's contribution to the scholarly community. Needless to say, his writings are often cited, respected. His scholarship on the history of the federal rules remain the definitive text. And he proves to be a prescient observer of the American legal system. But here again, Steve contributes in other ways to the scholarly community. Now, because of Steve Subrin, BSS, many of the civil procedure professors attending the annual meeting of the Association of American Law Schools would gather at a, you know, great local restaurant. It's always a great restaurant because of Joan Subrin. for what Steve organized yearly as the Field Family Forum. And the Field Family Forum is the yearly debate on important subjects such as the relative merits of beignets versus tacos, boxers versus briefs. That was a very good session. East versus West, and I have to admit, this year I've been drafted to defend the color red in red versus white. So if any of you have any suggestions, come see me after. But for many civil proceduralists, the Field Family Forum proved to be the main reason to attend ALS. And again, BSS, or because of Steve Subrin, civil procedure was made fun and a scholarly community is built. And so thank you, Steve. Because of you, we have all learned to be more compassionate, to have more fun, and in general, be a stronger teacher, scholar, and a human being.
Hi, everyone. My name is Heather Yontz. I'm a 2007 graduate. Before I had the luxury of calling Steve my friend, I was his student. My first class with Steve was actually my first class at Northeastern Law. And so while I'm sitting there nervously arranging my notebooks and my pens over and over again, Steve Subrin walks into the front of the room. "Call me Steve," was the first thing he said. And he picks up a piece of chalk and writes a phone number on the board. "This is my home number." And with that, I wasn't just a student in a class. By sharing his home number, he was inviting me and the other students into his life. And it would be safe to say that I took that invitation. I stopped by Steve's office after class one day to ask him a question, but within a few minutes, he was the one asking questions. "Where am I from? What do I want to do? How long have I been married?" By the time I left, I came to the realization that Steve and I share a lot of common interests: college basketball, a hatred of a certain college team, which will go unnamed, reading. But I also came to the realization that Steve cared about me and what I became. And that's the thing about Steve. The conversation just doesn't end with the law. He's interested in the kind of person you are, the kind of role you're going to play in this life. I had the amazing opportunity to work on a law and literature class with Steve, and he was clear from the start that the goal of our class was to use books as a mirror to figure out what kind of lawyer, what kind of person we wanted to be moving forward. The students wrote reflection pieces about themselves, and all of our conversations focused on the books, but also on the lives of the students in the class, because that's the kind of teacher Steve is. It's all about us, his students, the people who know him, the people in this room. So I'm going to do the one thing I think Steve wants to do and tell him a little bit about us. Steve knows everybody here, but I want to tell him something different. So get ready for a little class participation. I want you to raise your hand if you had Steve as your law professor. I want you to raise your hand if you know what it means when Steve says, after a pause, "Well, it means you're wrong." I want you to raise your hand if Steve inspired you to be a better lawyer. Okay, so here's the big one. I don't want you to raise your hands for this one. If you are able, get up from your chair and stand if Steve inspired you to become a better person. Thank you, Steve.
My name is Judy Brown, and I worked with Steve and taught with Steve for 30 years. During that time, he taught me a lot of things, but it's getting late, so I'll only tell you three of them. The first thing he taught me is this: always be the last speaker. I used to think before I met Steve that it was important to go first. You know, I always liked opening statements better than closing arguments because I could set the stage, control the narrative. You know, we all taught you, have everybody work off of your draft, not their draft. But Steve soon convinced me I was wrong. It's best to go last, he said, because that way you can sum up and rebut what everybody else said. So let me give you an example. Picture a typical faculty meeting. Everyone is bored. Everyone is fidgeting. Everyone is doing something else in order to avoid listening to whoever is speaking make the same arguments that he or she makes every faculty meeting, no matter what the topic under discussion is. With just minutes to go, Steve would raise his hand and begin what Dan and I called his rabbinic school closing. It went something like this. Did I ever tell you, dear colleagues, that once I wanted to be a rabbi? I attended the seminary for 6 months before I decided it was a romantic but flawed career choice. But while I was there, I learned how important it was to respect all points of view. And I so enjoy hearing yours, my dear colleagues. And as always, you have made me think about my own position so carefully. And as I was telling my wife, Joni, last night, and at this point, Steve would kind of squinch up his face and scratch what few hairs remained on his head. Steve would try and look upset, and here's what I said, Joni, just this once, I'm going to have to disagree with my fellow faculty members. I hope they will understand and forgive me. This was, of course, utter horseshit. Look pained, Steve said. Act humble. Be modest. Take the high road. Let them think you love them. The theory was that he could woo folks to his side by being the good cop and letting me and Dan Gavelber be the bad cops. And of course, beneath this pseudo-gentle demeanor was the razor-like mind of the most tenacious advocate, brilliant tactician, and one of the toughest, most clever lawyers I know. Steve hates to lose and rarely did. Ready for the second lesson? Always let Judy Brown edit your manuscripts. As you know, Steve is an innovative, rigorous, and prolific scholar. The emphasis is on the word prolific. Steve cared so passionately that the audience, who he always called the dear reader, understand exactly what he was saying, that he wrote in the more words the merrier style of prose. Think Dickens, not Hemingway. Steve never met an adjective he didn't love. He repeated each point endlessly, so that even the slowest dear reader couldn't help but understand. His parentheticals gave birth to more parentheticals in an exponential explosion. There were so many words that the reader was literally breathless before the next punctuation mark. One day, many years ago, when we were having lunch, not only did Steve go to good restaurants in those days, he always had a martini at lunch. Steve was bemoaning the fact that his 300-page-plus opus on the history of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure had been rejected. I mentioned that I like to edit, and that his manuscript was perhaps a tad too long for the average law review. And that was the beginning of a wonderful collaboration. I managed to reduce 300 pages to 100. The first cut was easy. I deleted, for example, the long story about the snowy weather in New Haven, the night that Charles Clark delivered an early draft of the federal rules. Next, I established a no more than two adjectives before every noun rule. That alone eliminated 50 pages. I eliminated everything else I didn't like and stuck it in the footnotes. Over the years we worked together, Steve wrote and wrote, and I cut and cut. And if truth be told, the dear reader did just fine. The last thing I learned from Steve was the most important. This is what Steve used to call, it's time for the hard-hitting conclusion. Steve made me understand how procedure is transubstantive, how it undergirds everything, how the up-the-revolution subjects that I taught were utterly incomprehensible without a firm grasp of civil procedure. Because of Steve, generations of lawyers that he and I and Dan and Margaret and the rest of you here helped to unleash upon the world now realize how critical the prima facie case is in even the most abstruse reaches of constitutional theory. And they understood more about the complex allocations of the burden of proof than many of their contemporaries. I continued to teach this way and to talk about procedure in all of the teaching about the Constitution that I have done since I retired. Many of my students in those years were retired lawyers and judges who claimed that they had never understood constitutional law. They were amazed to learn, however, that the erosion of Roe versus Wade and the Texas abortion case now before the court is really about the reallocation of the burden of proof and the weakening of the standard of proof. The same holds true for the so-called religious exception to birth control cases and even the voter suppression cases. Many of those students thanked me profusely for finally understanding constitutional law. And every time that happened, I thank you, Steve, in my heart for opening my eyes. Welcome to the world of the happily retired.
Terrible light up there. It's taken all of 70 years for me to finally get the bar mitzvah party that my brother got. But the best part about it is that no one's told me I had to thank Aunt Frumpke or to tell them thank you for the cufflinks and the pens. I can just decide to thank whoever I want. Of course, all of us owe a debt of thanks to Miel and Stacy, Megan, and Jeremy, thank you. For you to have come here and have to have a retirement party after retirement party is asking a lot, but we all really appreciate it, and I certainly do. So thank everybody who helped out on this. I want to talk about three things in the hour and a half that Miel allotted to me. I want to dispel some myths. I want to talk a little bit about the future of the law school and why. I want to explain to you why my granddaughters, Niamh and Leah, ought to get early admittance to Northeastern Law School. So I'm going to go in that order. And for Tom and Dan and Judy who've edited me, these three topics merge a little bit, but don't worry, there will be some separation. You can edit it later. on the mythology front, I told Judy Brown for all those years that I wanted to talk last, knowing, as all trial lawyers know, that of course the most important place is to talk first, where you set the stage. That's why Maura got to talk first, our Attorney General, knowing that if I told Judy I wanted to talk first each time, I'd end up talking last. Because it worked for 30 years. It was great. The second myth I want to talk to you about is a little self-generated. For a lot of years, my kids would, they were in college, or they'd come back and they say they met a student from Northeastern who said, I taught him civil procedure evidence, and it was pretty good class, et cetera. And you begin to swallow your own Kool-Aid after a while, you think you're okay. So a few weeks after I taught my last class in civil procedure, I ran into Janine, who's now a clerk for the SJC, and Janine said, Steve, now that it's all over, well, putting the finality part aside, I tried to listen. Putting it all over, she said, what do you think about your teaching after all these years? I said, and I took it seriously. I said, I think I've been a pretty good teacher to very good law students. She said, Steve, every teacher is a good teacher to very good students. Having put me in my place, I decided to think about the mythology of the law school. And Judy, this is the second point. One thing Judy and I and Dan and all the others have been told, what a great thing it was for you guys to create a cooperative law school. That cooperative legal education is really fabulous. The fact of the matter is that the trustees told us, not me, but Tom O'Toole and the other people, they said, you could reopen the law school if the graduates give you some money, and if it's a cooperative law school. So the truth of the matter is we did not invent it, but we did embrace it. And for that, we can take some credit. It really is fabulous that we learned that the students would learn more in that 1 year out of the building than in the 2.5 years they were in the building. The other myth was, how great it is we created a law school that was committed to social justice, which it was, and which my colleagues have believed in ever since. But think of the timing. Tom O'Toole was thinking about this in He was thinking about it when? In 1967, started in 1968, the reopened law school. There were five other law schools in the city. You would have to be pretty dopey not to concentrate during the civil rights movement with the feminist movement taking place, with women having raised family coming back to law school, not having a law school committed to social justice. But the fact is, we believed it, and we bought it. But it wasn't our creation. Finally, though, the one thing I think all of us can be proud of is the tone of the law school. No one told us to do that. And I've thought a lot about this, whether I'm making it up or whether it's really the truth, but there are a lot of people here who were around at the time or very shortly after. It's got to have been the law school in the world that most thought that students were the most important part of a law school. We really did believe that the school was there for the students. And many people contributed to that, but John Flynn, Carl, have spent literally hundreds of hours making sure that students would be heard. And I can't tell you the number of times that Judy Brown would say to Dan or to me or at a meeting, is it good for the kids? That's what she called it. Is it good for the kids? Of that, I think we can be very, very proud. There's a lot in legal education and the education at Northeastern that makes it hard to spend as much time with the students and in the building that we could when there were fewer students, right? We were creating a new thing. It was exciting. Let me tell you a few of them. Among other things, the law professors being hired today have PhDs. They've had 3 years having a writing experience at Harvard, Stanford, NYU, or something like that. By the time they get to law school, they've already published a lot. But to get tenure now, it's incredible. I mean, it's not only several articles, it's now what books do you have planned? The whole legal profession, or at least the teaching profession, has become interdisciplinary. So that means these young teachers not only have to be good in their PhD, not only do they have to be good in the field of law, they're being asked to be good with other professors at the university, and this is all great. But all of this puts terrific burdens on my colleagues, let alone the computer, where for hours people are sitting at a computer and put into that international law, where my colleagues are traveling all over the world. And there, at our law school, there are more conferences in a week or two than we ever had in a year. But the good news is that there's a way we can remain as student-centered as we've always been. I could give you a lot of examples, but I want to talk a minute about Margaret Burnham's civil rights, civil justice project, for which she has recently gotten a Carnegie Fellowship. I didn't see Margaret here tonight, but I'm... But here's a project dedicated to teaching students to go out there and learn what happened in the most horrible, horrible lynchings from the 30s or 40s on, to interview the live witnesses, to make sure it's recorded. She's done this also with the Journalism School of the Law School. She's done it with the Southern University. Alumni have contributed to it. The faculty has contributed to it. So you have this combination of energy that's still student-centered, serving the country and serving the world. I would think that what we can do to keep that people-centered is to have the graduates and the faculty together involve the students as much as we can in all of our projects. I mean, one of the projects we were all involved in was getting more elected, which might have been one of the great things we did in the last 2 years. And of course, we're next going to have our graduate elected as a senator in New Hampshire. So I want to leave you with that thought, that all of us, and by the way, Larry and Maura have done a fabulous job hiring our students and our graduates. And so what you can do to keep the students involved so that they have the feeling that this is a special place where we care for each other and work together on important projects would be great. And now, why I think you should admit Leah and Neab to law school right now. I don't think they'll be interested, by the way. I think it's more likely that Leah will either be an actress or make films like her Aunt Elizabeth, or she might do stand-up comedy like her Aunt Jennifer. And Neab will either probably be an artist like her father or raise horses. But you still ought to admit them, starting with Leah. Leah started the third grade this year, is that right, Jenny? I can't see it. Second grade this year. So it was about 2 weeks into it, the teacher, who turned out to be a fabulous teacher, said, I'm going to give you people a test in the next few days, and I don't want anyone talking to each other or even mouthing words. You know what that happened, what that provoked for Leah, who instantly turned to her neighbor and started a conversation. A little healthy resistance to authority. The best part of that story is, I think, is that Leah then came home and told the story to Julie and David with, like, so what, you know? Teacher said to do this, I did that, that was it. It was just the most natural thing in the world. And then there's Neab, who you can talk to tonight. Neab has loved horses for as long as I can remember. At least from the time Neab was three, I remember her playing with him. And she asked Dennis and Jennifer if she could take riding lessons. So at age five, they finally relented. They went to Harwich. And she got put on a pony, and it all started. She's been having lessons ever since. So after it was over, and by the way, those of you who worry about hearsay, it's either an excited utterance or it might have been a present sense impression, but I'm pretty sure this is a true story. So I said, Neab, so what do you think? She said, you know, they put me on it, and it was, she's still not real tall, and she said, I was a little afraid, this is age five, she said, but I dreamt about doing this all my life, and I decided I'm just going to do it. So there you have it, you having two grandchildren at a very young age, a healthy resistance to authority, and an insistence in following your dreams, even if you're afraid. Aren't those the values that... I mean, isn't that what we tried to do for the last, for 48 years now? So thank you for letting me follow my dreams. I can't remember a time I didn't want to teach. I've always wanted to have conversations with bright people. I was a history and literature major, and that's really what I've liked to do, is history and literature. And here's a job for 46 years. I got to teach and be with very bright, interesting people, write some history and teach law and literature. I'm forever grateful to the eight of you. I really appreciate what you said, and all of you for coming, some of you from a long way away. Let's go drink.
So, Steve, I can't promise that I can hold on as dean long enough for your granddaughters to be admitted to law school, but I'll leave a note for my successor, because I think that's a great idea. So, I promised Steve that I wouldn't do this, but you can never trust the dean. So, many people I know are thinking after a wonderful evening such as this, and thank you so much to all the great professors. Doesn't Northeastern breed great oral advocacy skills? So I'm sure many of you are thinking, is there anything that we can do to honor Steve in light of this one wonderful occasion? And the answer to that question is, yes, there is. So we have a friend of the law school who has established an endowed fund named the Gilbert Subrin Public Interest Co-op Fund. To further celebrate Steve and Dan's work. Other graduates have joined in to help with this already. Many of you have contributed. And I ask all of you who have not yet done so to think about giving a gift in Steve's name, because it certainly would help to further the legacy that he has created. So thank you again very much, everyone, for coming. And now we have one last part of our celebration. So I'd like to call to the podium Miel Marquis. Miel and Steve have partnered for many, many years on alumni events, and we're grateful for all the work that she has done. This whole event would not have happened without her work, so let's give her a round of applause. Thank you. So the law school is providing Steve with a beautiful easel and paint set. So, and there's also a beautiful memory book with inscriptions. And downstairs, one of our graduates has prepared a quilt. And those of you, right near, it's by the coat check, if those of you who want to sign. So now we really can go and drink, and Steve, congratulations.